It is a great pleasure to be here today and to have this opportunity to talk to you about Alexander Archipenko. My lecture is structured chronology, giving an overview of the artist's life and work. To me, it's important to emphasize the range of Archipenko's creative legacy and to show how his language has informed our thinking of modern sculpture. As an innovator, sculptor, painter, draftsman, printmaker, writer, and educator, he contributed significantly to the language of modern art. Archipenko described himself as an artist inventor and explained how he embraced modernity and the innovations of the 20th century. In his artistic practice, he also followed a strong belief in the spiritual in art as a base for creativity. This creative path took him from Ukraine to Russia, to France, to Germany, and finally to the United States, where he continued his peripatetic lifestyle, exhibiting and teaching at various locations, including New York, Los Angeles, and Chicago. He was born in 1887 here in Kiev, and of course he grew up seeing stylized Byzantine imagery, including icons painted by his grandfather, as well as architecture of Greek Orthodox churches such as St. Sophia. He later also remembered the stone babas, the ancient totem-like sculptures, which he found powerful and mysterious. He studied at the Kiev Art School from 1902 until 1905, went to Moscow in 1906, and then emigrated to Paris at the end of 1908. As you know, the beginning of the 20th century was a period of extraordinary cultural transformation, and Archipenko contributed with a series of innovations that were crucial in the advancement of modern sculpture. Generally, he is acknowledged for his contributions to Cubism. It doesn't work here. I'm just waiting for the translator. Are we? Okay, great. This portrait, one of the earliest preserved photographs, shows the artist at work on seated torso, dressed in suit and tie underneath his smock. He is captured in profile, holding a sculpting tool in his right hand as if modeling the leg of the sculpture, an abstracted, crouching figure. Apparently, Archipenko is shown as a modeler rather than a carver. He is holding a modeling tool instead of chisel and hammer. Rather than starting with a block of wood or stone and reducing and shaping the material to its final form, Archipenko preferred to build up his sculptures, often with the help of an inner amateur. Or he cast materials such as plaster, terracotta, cement, or artificial stone in a mold. Many of these sculptures, including seated torso with a height of 38 centimeters, illustrate his preference for a smaller, intimate size. This photograph, which seems carefully composed, points us to Archipenko's choice of the female figure as a significant vessel for his sculptural explorations. I would like to mention too that conceptually, seated torso makes reference to antique torsos. Its crouching position in particular alludes to representations of Venus that Archipenko might have studied during his visits at the Louvre and the Ethnographic Museum at the Trocadero. For many artists in Paris, Venus meant a signifier for artistic creativity. Here we see a caricature from 1912, where you see two Parisian ladies in front of a sculpture by Archipenko titled Venus. Representations of Venus were a common imagery known to the Parisian audience. By adapting the subject of the goddess, Archipenko pointed to his mastery of the subject. I'm sorry, this is not working for me. What am I doing wrong? It doesn't seem to work. I'm sorry. Oh, the black button. Okay, thank you. Sorry, it was me, not the device. Okay. Returning to this photograph, it then stages the artist as working on his ideal. Oh, I'm so sorry. This is really terrible. Okay. With a new formal language that in its use of abstractation and fragmentation addresses modernity. My attention on this image serves to introduce elements of Archipenko's practice, including his focus on the female figure, allusions to Venus, archaic references, simplification of form, but also his use of photography. Archipenko established these elements early in his practice and embraced them throughout his lifelong career. This photograph is also an important marker in time in that it portrays the artist as an accomplished sculptor after his emigration to Paris. This new formal language can be found also in this work, Seated Woman from 1912, with fragmentation as well as concave and convex shapes used to abstract the female figure. The interplay of positive and negative space breaks with the tradition of a monolithic sculpture. He embraced negative space also in this work, Walking, where the void, the immaterial, becomes the core of the sculpture. In other works, for example, here in Medrano, he experimented with different material, leading to this construction of wood, glass, sheet metal, wire, and color, which we can see. He introduced color here in Carousel Pierrot. And like his contemporaries, Archipenko investigated movement and time. Not only in his sculptural work, but also in the two-dimensional. For example, in this print reproduced in the Italian futurist publication La Cerba, where he created two dynamic bodies with a few lines and forms. How to address time in sculpture. How to make a still object express movement. Here, Archipenko turned to the subject of dance. Two dancers embrace a materialized empty space, which becomes the center of the sculpture. He created a dialogue between the figures and the void, between concave and convex forms. He was, of course, familiar with cubo-futurist experimentation in dance, which he encountered, for example, in the Ballet Russe and in the performances of Louis Fuller and Isadora Duncan. In the creative community, dance not only became a symbol of modernism, but also for the creative investigation of body and space, dynamic movement, rhythm and simultaneity. The artist commented in retrospect how he broke through compact volumes and replaced a hand or a leg with modeled voids, an analogy to the pause in a musical composition. His explorations of the subject were acknowledged internationally. In 1913, the British journal The Sketch reproduced on its cover an image of dance. It is important to note that Archipenko's explorations of the dance theme grew out of his creative contacts. The idea of simultaneity in particular was important for a group of poets, artists, musicians, and dancers who contributed to the journal Monjoie, including Sonia and Robert Delaunay, and the set designer Leon Bakst. Between 1910 and 1914, Archipenko exhibited regularly with the historic avant-garde, including the now famous Armory Show. Here we have an installation shot of the Salon d'Automne in Brussels in 1914. And you can see his work in the center of the room. On the left, you see Gondolier, and in the background, there is another version of Medrano. The poet, writer, and art critic Guillaume Apollinaire was his strongest advocate, as was Herbert Walden of Der Sturm, who promoted him in Germany and internationally. When Archipenko first arrived in Paris, he did not speak French, and he naturally relied on common experience and shared language. He joined, for example, the Ukrainian Association in Paris, and as he continued to establish himself in the Parisian milieu, he became an important figure for other Russian-speaking émigrés, including at the artist colony La Ruche. Considered an insider of the modern art scene, he contributed, for example, a review of the 1911 Salon des Indépendants for the Russian-language newspaper Parisky Vestnik. The newspaper, published in Paris, was an important source of information for many émigrés. In his report of the exhibition, Archipenko recognized the influences of many previous styles to modern art, including classical, Byzantine, and Egyptian art, exposing his own knowledge of these styles. True to his symbolist heritage, he emphasized, though, that artists should incorporate not only the stylistic elements, but also spirituality and inner values. It is not surprising that in this article he discussed especially Wilhelm Lehmbruck and Vasily Kandinsky. During this time, Archipenko was also in contact with Alexandra Exter, and as Dr. Christina Loder has recently revealed, in friendly correspondence with Malevich. For example, when Malevich exhibited at the 1914 Salon des Indépendants, he reported that he had received a letter from Archipenko from Paris telling him that he, Malevich, was a success with the French artists. Sharing artistic and social concerns, Archipenko was clearly a central figure. He was in active contact with the artists of the Section d'Or, as well as with the Italian futurists, German expressionists, and artists of the Eastern European and Russian avant-gardes. During the First World War, he relocated to the south of France, where he developed painted mixed media constructions that he called sculptor paintings. Here we have an example of Before the Mirror or in the Boudoir from 1915. It shows a female figure and her reflection in a mirror behind a dressing table. The two images, one yellow and the green reflection, are mingled. Shiny sheet metal actually covers portions of the mirror. There's a still life in the foreground. Interestingly, he included a real object. The yellow painted picture that you see in the lower left corner contains an actual photograph of the artist. It has been suggested that these works embody aspects of Eastern European traditions, including references to icons. Archipenko considered the sculptor paintings his biggest achievements, and he subsequently revisited this idea in the 1950s. Looking at these works so far, it has become clear that while he was interested in abstraction, he never abandoned the human figure, and especially the female figure. Here are some other examples of signature pieces. On the left, you see a flat torso, and on the right, a wide torso. After the war, Archipenko exhibited widely in Europe, including at the 1920 Venice Biennale, and in the United States, where he had a solo exhibition at the Société Anonyme in New York in 1921. In his private life that year, he married Angelika Forster, a known German expressionist sculptor, and moved to Berlin. Angelika was the daughter of a prominent German architect and had established important social and artistic contacts that she now shared with her husband. Especially between 1921 and 1923, he exhibited widely, and he witnessed the publication of numerous monographs and articles on his work. In this photograph, taken at a private interior setting, the artist is seated comfortably in an armchair with two women, a faience, placed on the round table beside him. Responding to audience demand, Archipenko investigated possibilities of reproduction that were popular in Germany. Walter Gropius' Bauhaus ideas influenced artists to embrace different opportunities for sculptural reproduction. The renowned Meissen Porcelain Factory, for instance, was a significant sponsor of artists' editions. Similarly, Archipenko too produced works in glazed ceramic. Different from the previous portrait, Archipenko is not shown wearing an artist's smock and holding a modeling tool, but with a suit and tie, likely having a catalog for one of his exhibitions in hand. It is a portrait of a successful artist entrepreneur at ease with manufacturing methods that did not involve direct modeling or carving by the artist. In Berlin, he also hired a stone carver to reproduce works in marble. Reclining Woman, for example, illustrates a stylistic change towards a classicizing that the artist favored since his relocation to Germany. He also made lithographs and contributed a print to the Bauhaus portfolio. This fitted with the work of several German expressionist artists who also were attached to producing editions in order to reach a wider audience. In Berlin, just like previously in Paris, Archipenko was again a central figure, including for Russian-speaking artists and writers, such as Laszlo Moholy-Nagy, then a correspondent for the Hungarian magazine Ma, for Karel Teige, the theoretical leader for the art group Devitzel in Prague, and Ljubomir Micic, the editor of the journal Zenit in Yugoslavia. Also, Archipenko was prominent and well-connected. Financial security was a strong concern. The inflation of the Weimar Republic paralyzed the commercial life and caused a crisis in the artistic community. This was a motivating force for the artist and Angelika, his wife, to leave Germany in 1923. Oh boy. Okay, here we have a portrait of the couple on their way to the United States. In the United States, Archipenko continued making art for the next 40 years. He also was an engaging educator, and he taught at many universities and art schools, including his own that he founded in New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, and in Bearsville near Woodstock. Interestingly, when he first arrived in New York, he focused on the applied arts. From 1924 on, he became engaged in inventing an apparatus for displaying changeable pictures, Archipentura. It was later destroyed and is only documented in photographs and drawings. How did it work? Apparently, it was an electronic device that could display several preloaded images by rolling painted canvas through a complicated system of sprockets and belts, similar to the workings of a mechanical billboard. Archipenko thought that it could be used commercially and patented it, intending it to do for painting what the motion picture did for photography. His machine produced moving art, a miracle, as the opening image indicated. While it displayed an abstract geometrical shape at first, once started, the device showed female figures changing clothes and undressing. Here we have another view. It was quite a spectacle, and to accompany the painted model's performance, Archipenko asked Edgar Varèse, a notable composer and friend from Paris, to write a music score. Continuing his interest in the applied arts, he also opened ARCO, a school for ceramics. Our research on this subject has only just begun, and here we have, for example, notes on ARCO stationery that we found in our archives, and they give us some clues, including the location on West 61st Street in New York City. The sheet refers to different sorts of clay, ingredients, and prices for the glazes. Archipenko published also an article discussing the history of ceramics and explaining the concept of ARCO as a school that supports the production of sculptural editions to provide income to the artists. It was an idea very close to the Bauhaus concept. At the end of the 1920s, he felt disappointed with his experience in the US. He could not really reconnect to the same level of recognition that he had previously held in Europe. From letters to his brother, we learn of the hardship of his immigration. And I would like to thank Vita Susak for mentioning these letters to me. In fact, Archipenko felt rather isolated, partly because of the language barrier. When he arrived in New York, he did not speak English at all and communicated through his wife, who spoke English. The couple spoke French to each other as their shared language. At the beginning of the 1930s, Archipenko began working on a new group of works from which he developed the mass sculptures, a series of female figures representing incarnations from higher spiritual realms. He first presented the Ma figures at his exhibition at the Ukrainian Pavilion at the World Fair, A Century of Progress in Chicago in 1933. This exhibition marked the beginning of his connecting with the Ukrainian exile community in the United States. And the National Museum in Lviv acquired several works on paper and a Ma figure, which sadly later was destroyed. Archipenko turned to the Ukrainian exile community for moral and financial support, and over the next years he accepted several commissions that reconnected him with the heritage of his homeland. Here, for example, we have a photo showing him working on San Vladimir, which was a commission for the Cleveland Cultural Garden. In 1935, Archipenko moved to Hollywood in California, where he joined his wife. Angelica had left her husband a few years earlier in 1929 to travel extensively, including to Southeast Asia and Japan. After her return to the United States, she moved to Hollywood. And it was Galka Shire, a promoter of modernism in the United States. She worked with the Blue Four, Kandinsky, Yavlensky, Feininger, and Klee. And she was a close friend. And she facilitated this relocation and connected Archipenko with institutions on the West Coast. This portrait, taken in California, shows the artist working on torso in space. He is holding a modeling tool, seemingly engaged in shaping and refining the sculpture. His gaze is not directed towards us, but focused on his activity, illustrating his attention on sculptural processes. Initially, Archipenko created torso in space in terracotta, which he polished. Subsequently, he realized it in different sizes, materials, and additions, including a metallized terracotta that we see here, but also in bronze and aluminum. The idea of the female torso floating in space inspired collages and prints as well. In California, Archipenko felt comfortable and optimistic. He had reconnected with his wife, he opened an art school, and he lectured and exhibited widely. He said in retrospect that in California he made the best body of work while in the United States. Indeed, working almost exclusively with terracotta, he realized over 50 new sculptures, creating the largest body of new work since his days in Europe. These works are not widely known, and I was very excited when we could include some of the ceramics in the last Archipenko retrospective. Here is an installation view from Penn State University. The range of these ceramics is extensive and varied in terms of structure, color, contrast, and texture. Notably, Archipenko revisited earlier formal elements such as the void and color. Here is an example seated figure. And here another seated figure from 1938. He experimented with different possibilities of surface treatment, creating sculptures that were built out of two tones, polished, painted polychrome, made with inlays or covered with silver, chrome, or gold. This floating torso is another example, a terracotta electroplated with silver. It was owned at one time by one of his students married to Lindheim. I'm showing you this because Mary described very eloquently her time with Archipenko and his practice. He gave her this work as a gift, and she wrote, and I'm quoting from a letter, The sculpture is one which Archipenko did in Hollywood during the 1935-36 period. He was concentrating at that time on terracotta, having the use of a large industrial kiln for the firing. He was also fascinated with the process of electroplating silver or copper on ceramic forms. The sculpture I have is from the time when he was doing a series of floating forms, or forms in space, as he referred to them. It was built up, as were all of his terracottas of that period, by pressing the clay solidly around an upright pipe threaded into a flange below an elevated board. When the form was finished and had stiffened sufficiently, the pipe was removed from below, leaving an air vent to avert explosion during the firing. If, as was the case with this figure, there remained a large part of the sculpture still solid, Archipenko neatly cut out, removed it, and carved out the interior to form a sizable vent connected with the one made by the pipe. Then he replaced the removed section and carefully joined and resurfaced the piece. After firing, he stoned the figures, in part or in entirety, to a satiny finish. The one I selected was one which he then had electroplated with silver. The signature was impressed into the clay before the firing. What a wonderful and clear account of the artist's process. Oh, yeah. I didn't do it. Sorry, it's just not working for me. Okay, let's see. Go through this again. Okay. Almost. Archipenko left California in 1937 when the artist Laszlo Moholy-Nagy, a friend from Berlin and the founding director of the new Bauhaus in Chicago, invited him to be the head of the modeling workshop. Archipenko's instructions at the Chicago Bauhaus were much appreciated and fit well with the program of the institution. He continued working in ceramics. Okay. Catherine Koo, a Chicago-based dealer and curator who advocated modern art, was the first to exhibit and market the terracotta sculptures. She supported Archipenko noticeably and included his work in at least 9 exhibitions from 1937 until the gallery's closing in 1942. Archipenko returned to the East Coast during the Great Depression. I don't know. Oh, yeah. He first relocated to upstate New York. Since 1924, he had been teaching in Woodstock during the summer. And he and his wife had purchased land in Bearsville, a hamlet near Woodstock. Here he began constructing a summer art studio with a pottery kiln and a multi-level building for a summer art school. While he embraced the natural setting, he saw this too as an alternative to living in expensive New York City, and he expected to have income from teaching. He constructed the school building with the help of students using material from nearby abandoned houses. Here we see an image of the finished school. The summer art school offered a natural setting for the students. Archipenko's interest of combining architecture, nature, and history was shared by friends, the American designers Mary and Russell Wright, who built their modernist home Manitoga only 60 miles south of Archipenko's summer residence in Garrison, New York. After the Second World War, Archipenko focused on sculpting light. He built a machine that allowed him to carve acrylic glass. This material is also sometimes called plexiglass, perspex, or lucite. He worked the surfaces so that they guide and reflect light in a certain way. And I'm quoting, "Following my way of inventions in sculpture, I now use the conductivity of light in plastic. This success in modeling light has come after much experimentation. The plastic works consist of four aesthetic elements. First, modeling of space. Second, concave. Third, transparency. And as the fourth element, the modeling of light affected by electricity." These works were last shown in an exhibition at the Ukrainian Museum in New York, and we have here an installation view. He made 10 acrylic glass sculptures, and they all had an added built-in electric light source so that the works could be illuminated from within. Using translucent material was not only a formal affair for Archipenko, but it also allowed him to illustrate his belief in the spiritual content of art. He wrote in 1955, and I'm quoting, "This area of expression has great and varied possibilities. It doesn't belong to the art of today or tomorrow, but embodies timeless spiritual truths produced by a new material and light." The 1950s were active and turbulent years. Archipenko taught and lectured extensively. He also continued writing a significant text explaining his complex thoughts on art and creativity. Moreover, he had several large exhibitions, including a retrospective in Germany. In his personal life, his wife Angelica died in 1957 after a long illness. In 1960, he published his monograph, 50 Creative Years, and he married Frances Gray, a former student. Frances has recently published a comprehensive memoir telling us about her life with Archipenko. During the 1950s, he revisited the sculpture paintings, a concept, as we have seen, first realized during the First World War. Multicolored Figure is an example of this group of works. Here he revisited many elements of his earlier works and at the same time points to elements of his creative vocabulary: color, material, form, abstraction, fragmentation, reflection, and the motif of the female figure. We can see the artist's creative language associated with cubism, such as fragmentation and concave and convex forms, but also his new approach to color, space, and material. I suggest reading Multicolored Figure as a creative link to the past. This is an idea that was at the core of Archipenko's thinking. He was influenced by the vitalist writings of the French philosopher Henri Bergson. Bergson's writings were read and discussed in the artist circles in Paris, and Archipenko revisited the writings in the 1930s. He subscribed in particular to Bergson's thoughts about the importance of memory as a dynamic link between past and present, and the importance of intuition. He completed several sculpture paintings during the 1950s. These incorporated materials such as mother of pearl, formica, and bakelite. And I have here some examples. Here's Cleopatra from 1957. It's actually really cool when you see it in motion because of the mirror that is one of the surfaces. And I was thinking of this piece when Professor Mudrock talked about how the viewers were supposed to be part of the artwork of Bogomazov, I believe. And I think it's the same idea that Archipenko revisited in this later piece. I think we can move on if, thank you. During the 1950s, Archipenko began most of his bronze editions, including the Bronze Queen of Sheba. He also investigated options for larger monuments. Here is King Solomon, and this is a painted plaster, which was the model for an enlargement in Italy at the Fondazione Pagani near Milan. King Solomon is Archipenko's last work. It is thematically related to Queen of Sheba, the religious text account of the Queen of Sheba's famous visit to Solomon, and the two pieces can be considered complementary. Throughout Archipenko's oeuvre, we can find archaic references, another link to the past, which he acknowledged. And here is a note in his handwriting. I will read it for you. The quality of my work cannot be measured by its abstractness as conservatism, by its geometrical angularity as curvatures, but only by the large totality of its content and its variety of expression. My old works contain elements of the new, and the new contain elements of the old. By eating only a single apple, one cannot judge the size of the apple tree. History proves that works of art with a truly spiritual content remain immune to criticism. In ending, I would like to say a few words about the Archipenko Foundation. Francis Archipenko Gray started the foundation in 2001. The foundation is located in the former art school near Woodstock, and we maintain the artist's archives and the website archipenko.org, which offers a comprehensive chronology. Our programs include expertise of works attributed to Archipenko, but also exhibitions and publications. Recently, we launched the online sculpture catalog Resonate. This has become a priority because we understand how important it is to explain the artist's processes of production and to create more transparency. In the panel that's following this afternoon, Matthew Stevenson will talk a little bit more about the foundation. The overall mission of the foundation is to study the life and work of the artist and to protect his legacy. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a great lecture. Do you think, when we are talking about Alexander Archipenko, is there any very, the most important period in his art, which period you think is the most prominent for this artist? Я приведу, як ви вважаєте, чи є у Архипенка найбільш важливий період його творчості? От що саме ви вважаєте найбільш важливим?
Thank you for this question. You know, I think obviously he's known mostly as a Cubist sculptor. So we still to this date associate Archipenko with the works made in France, maybe up till 1920. Those are what in art historical writing is still considered his main contribution. Should I wait for the translation or?
No, it is okay. Yeah, it's gone.
But he struggled with this. Obviously, he had a very long career after 1920. And when he moved to the United States, he could not reconnect to that level of fame for many reasons. And he clearly made another body of work which is as important as the Cubist sculptures. And what he experienced was that even when he was in the United States, the audience demand, the demands of the art market were for the cubist sculptures. So he could not bring these new works to an audience as he had hoped to. And so now for us, it's the time and the opportunity to go back and look at those works and really examine them and understand the contribution that he made with these later works.
Дякую. Thank you. Будь ласка.
It was written on one of the slides that a sculpture was destroyed in 1952.
Mm-hmm.
Was it really 52 or 42? And if it was destroyed in the Soviet period,
yes,
what was the reason for the destruction?
Yes, I think you might be right that it was a typo. I think it was definitely
1942.
I think Vita might know about this. Was it 50? Yeah.
So 50. I can answer you because I'm from Lviv, where this sculpture was destroyed in 1952.
50, okay.
52. So it was a decision of new Soviet power to destroy all modernist and nationalist works. And we have a catalog of destroyed works which were in this National Museum. It's really a big catalog. Mm. This is quite strange. Why, in which way this figure in bronze was destroyed? But it was in 1952. Mm.
Thank you, Vita.
And one question.
Yeah.
I always is thinking about this famous sculpture, Gondolier. Right?
Yes.
You worked a lot about biography of Archipenko. Mm. Could you say when he was in Venice? Because I think he should be in Venice before and later create this sculpture. Do you have some materials or some facts that confirm that he was before 1914 in Venice?
I have never found anything about this, that he was in Venice before 1920.
When it was Biennale, but why he could create these works. And another short question, when he was in Moscow, do you have some materials that he studied in art school in Moscow? Yeah,
it's some. And he exhibited there. We have an exhibition catalog from 1906, I believe. Yeah.
But he exhibited, but if he studied at art school in Moscow.
I don't know if he studied at the art school.
Thank you.
I think he said in his writings, which, you know, he wrote many years later, that he went to Moscow for a brief time to exhibit. So I'm not sure if he went to a formal art school.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
I have one more question about the material with which the artist was working. So he, can you just make a short conclusion? The major material he started to work when he created his cubist artworks, and later he finished with bronze. And when did he start to work with bronze, actually? So
most of the bronzes were cast in the 1950s. There are early bronzes, but there are very, very few. The first few examples were in the Venice Biennale, but the majority of the bronzes were started really in the 1950s. At that time, when he left Europe for the United States, he left plaster models in Europe with friends. And at the end of the 1950s, he had access to these models again. So he used several of these models to do the bronze editions. So they are cast from early models. But then it gets a little bit more complicated because he did not have all the models. So he also recreated new versions of earlier works and then made bronze casts from those. And that's why it's so important that we have now the catalog Raisonné, because it's almost impossible without really intense study to even make that connection and see which bronze came from which model.
But now all the casts which left, they are kept by the foundation.
Yes, they are in the foundation and they are also in what we call the estate, which is basically the holdings of what Archipenko passed on to Frances Archipenko Gray and her family. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. Good.
One more question.
Okay. Okay. Mr. Chen.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Alexander, for a very enlightening lecture. Did you, in your research, ever come across the name of Johann Georg Pinsel, who was a sculptor from Galicia, so from this region? Because Altman, who was, of course, living with Archipenko at La Ruche in Paris, he did some kind of research into this sculptor, Pinsel, and made a painting based on one of his sculptures. And it seems to me, suspicion, that Zadkine also looked at this particular figure. Mm. And when you look at the dancing figures that Archipenko produced in 1913, 1914, you have the kind of elaborate movement that you would see in these Rococo sculpture as well. Did you ever come across this name?
Unfortunately, no, I haven't. But I, you know, now that you mention it, I will go back and double check.
I will show you what I have in terms of.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. I'm sure they knew each other, but the name is not familiar to me. Okay. But I will double check.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you. We have one more question. Для тих, хто приєднався до нас щойно, у нас є перекладачі, і можете взяти так девайс для перекладу. For those who joined us, we have simultaneous translation. You can use it. Please, who wanted to ask?
Thank you very much for your lecture. And I have a question about your foundation, Archipenko Foundation. Can you please tell more about the structure of it, about collection, and about with whom you collaborate and why? So which kind of projects you support or provide? Thank you.
Sure. As I said, I think my colleague Matthew Stevenson will talk a little bit more later. But in short, the foundation, the main goal so far has been to produce the catalogue Raisonné, and we collaborate with scholars, we organize symposiums, we do exhibitions and publications. Recently there have been two large exhibitions. One was a traveling retrospective that I curated, and it traveled through the United States and also to Scandinavia. And then there was an exhibition in New York fairly recently at Eiken MacLean Gallery that was organized with Matthew Stevenson, and that focused on the void, on Archipenko's use of the void. And we are just now juggling other ideas for exhibitions. And publications, I mentioned Frances Archipenko wrote a memoir that was published, I believe, maybe 2 years ago. And, you know, we are really open with cooperating with any institution and scholar. We look at the proposals, and whatever makes sense and is feasible, we would be more than welcome to support.
Дякую. Ще питання? І тут.
Архів видання. Будь ласка, дякую за вашу лекцію. Thank you very much for your great presentation. And it's very interesting for me personally. Have you any findings, discoveries while your work, and which one or many was the most impressive to the moment? Thank you.
Oh, wow. That would take all day. Well, I've had really the privilege to work at the foundation for over 10 years, and I work daily with archival material, and there's so much still to be discovered. It's really a treasure trove. What for me resonated the most, I think, is Archipenko's experience of multiple emigrations and how one adapts to different contexts, not speaking the language, leaving works behind, meeting famous art organizers and promoters. And I just really was interested in those daily aspects of a life of an artist immigré, and in several contexts, in France, Germany, and the United States, and at different times. When you think of it, when we think of modernism and modern art, right? Archipenko really worked in the locales, in the geographical places where modernism, Western modernism as we understand it, was defined and redefined. So those aspects are, for me, the most interesting.
Thank you so much. Ще питання? І це вже, мабуть, буде останнє, тому що ми переходитимо до круглого столу.
Pardon, простите, я буду говорити по-русски, но, наверное, переведут. В 70-х годах в Париже, в 70-х годах...
I'm sorry, someone will have to translate for me.
Вы не поняли?
Je parle français, mais pas...
Pas французский, я могу сказать.
Si,
да.
Français, voilà. Va.
En français, d'accord.
Oui.
Alors, dans les années 70, il y avait à Paris Donald Karshan.
Oui.
Et qui avait une grande collection, qui avait la collection de Archipenko. Mm-hmm. Et il avait donc sa compagne est morte, et puis il est reparti aux États-Unis. Il est mort lui-même. Et qu'est devenu cette archive qui était assez extraordinaire?
Ah,
qu'est
oui.
devenu l'archive de Donald Karshan?
Can I answer in English?
Oui. Okay.
He donated his... Donald... Wait a second. Okay. Oh.
I can... Был это для русскоязычных или украинскоязычных. Да. Был такой Дональд Каршан. Он друг Фрэнса. Он был другом Фрэнса. И у него огромная коллекция фон Архипенко. И он показывал, но он уехал, он жил тогда с той швейцаркой, которая умерла, мать его детей. И он вернулся в Америку. Ну, сам он умер уже давно. И я спросил, что стало из этого архива, этого огромного, замечательного архива.
So the question was about Donald Karshan, who worked with Francis Archipenko in the 60s, and he had a he was organizing many of the Archipenko retrospectives in the 60s, and he authored a print catalog, Raisonné, and his material was donated to the Smithsonian Archives in Washington. And you can find it online if you go in there finding it. And his art collection, he also had a large art collection, was dispersed. Some of it went to a museum in Florida, and other works were sold at auction, and others are still in his family collection. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry? No, it's, I'm sorry, I will have to, I can't remember it right now, but it's not this one. I can tell you later, it will come to me, I'm sorry. Yeah. No, he worked with the museum in Tel Aviv. He went there in, I believe, in the early 70s, and the Tel Aviv Museum made an exhibition And he wrote for the catalog. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much, Alexandra. Дуже дякую всім за питання, дуже дякую Олександрі за прекрасну доповідь. І зараз ми зробимо невеличку паузу для того, щоб підготуватися до наступної події, яка буде круглим столом. І цей круглий стіл присвячений українському внеску до світового авангарду. І це наш зірковий круглий стіл, в якому візьмуть участь Жан-Клод Маркаде, Мирослава Мудрак, Олег Хільницький, Віта Сусак. І модеруватиме його не менш зірковий Дмитро Горбачов. Тому давайте ми на 7-10 хвилин невеличку паузу зробимо і чекаємо вас назад на круглий стіл.